Everyone, welcome to the Midweek Podcast presented by our friends at Factory Backing, who are celebrating a 20th anniversary here. So make sure you check them out at factorybacking.com to make all kinds of cool custom graphics for all bikes, quads, et cetera, et cetera. So anyway, today I'm joined by two of my friends, Brandon Dunn and Jeff Springman of Bill's Pipes. Bill's Pipes is obviously back in the two-stroke days, there was like, I would say there was three big names, right? Pro Circuit, FMF, Bill's Pipes. Yeah. But yeah, so Bill's Pipes has been around for years and years. Founded by Bill Cervera, who's actually, he's your father-in-law?
Yep, stepdad.
Stepdad, yep. Okay. And yeah, so you guys are running the show now, and and here we are.
Yeah. So, yeah, it's been a long time. So we can cut anytime we want. So I didn't know if we wanted to bring up Bill's dementia or anything.
Oh yeah, sure. I mean, obviously Bill Cervera is the founder of Bill's Pipes, and you know, how old is Bill now?
So Bill is 74.
74.
Yeah.
Okay, so I would say the last time I really interacted with Bill was 6-7 years ago. Or right around the time you guys moved out of the Corona office.
So that was only like 4 years.
It was about 4 years.
Yeah. Okay.
It's about 4 years. Yeah. Between 4 and 5.
But so Bill is he's aging and is it dementia that he's got?
Yeah, he's got dementia. And it happened. Well, he had it for quite a long time that we really didn't know exactly. You know, and in the shop, I could see he was making some questionable decisions, you know, that normally it's common sense. Mm-hmm. And he always had great common sense. So there for a long time, I'm like, man, that was kind of not smart, Bill. Mm-hmm. Well, then, finally he did something really silly. So then my mom and sister took him to the doctor and he had dementia. So that was 5 years ago, 5 or 6. But he's gotten pretty bad
lately. Yeah.
Yeah. Lately. So his long-term is still really, really good.
Yeah.
Like for sure. He remembers you know, there's no problem there. And he can tell stories for days.
Yeah. From about factory Honda and, Suzuki,
you know, back in the day with Hannah and,
short-term.
Yeah.
It's tough,
right? But like, you know, we had a big party for him. And the next day I go over there to kind of do some cleanup. And I say, all right, Bill, I got to go. He goes, you always got to leave, man. I never see you. I go, Bill, we just had the party for you yesterday. What party? And I'm like, you don't remember? Donnie Banks flew in. There was tons of his friends. There was 15, 20 of his friends. He didn't remember.
Wow.
So,
I didn't realize it was that serious until, I think he called me and I missed his call and I called you and I said, hey, Bill called me. I got to call him back. And he was at your office. And so he was like, hey, do you have kids, Don? I'm like, you know my kids.
Right.
Because you bring them over to swim. Yeah. And we had a conversation. Then he called me back like half hour later. I thought, well, maybe he forgot to tell me something. He goes, Don, do you have kids? And I'm like, oh, man.
He gets stuck on certain things.
Yeah. So that, it is really. Yeah. It's too bad, you know, because I from 25 or so, I spent every day with him, you know, at work. Yeah. So. Yeah, it's sad to watch someone you love, you know, to go down that road. But I mean, a lot of people are dealing with it.
Yeah. So my friendship with Bill started in, I want to say 1990 when I started at Cycle News.
The three wheel.
No, it was after that. I started at Cycle News.
I thought I thought you were still riding three wheelers.
No. Three wheelers.
The Ducati King.
Yeah.
86 was my last three-wheeler.
All right.
So I started at Cycle News in 1990. And around 1991 or so, I remember I was building some project bikes. And so I approached Bill about pipes. And we kind of hit it off. And then he would hey, can I borrow that KX125 to make a pipe? And so we'd give him test bikes.
And
it's funny because we were we're pretty good pals. And that was when I still lived in Altadena. And there was times when he would drive out to Altadena at my parents' house to pick up a test bike or whatever.
Right.
And I remember when I moved to Corona, well, I obviously, in 2000, I started Trans World Motocross.
Mm-hmm.
And 2001, maybe, I moved to Corona. I remember I was telling him, I'm moving to Corona.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, man. And he drove out and saw my house when it was still a frame and everything.
Oh, yeah.
And we were talking about stuff. And then I want to say around 2002 or so. No. I'm sorry. It was before I moved in. I was showing him my house. Like, we have two garages, a two car and a one car.
Right.
And I was telling him, I'm going to turn this one car into a photo studio, you know. And he's like, oh, no, man, I'll give you my lunchroom. And so that's when that happened, 2001 or so. He cleared out the lunchroom and kicked out all your guys.
Yeah, because that's right. So we did. That's when we bought that building, was in 98.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, we'd already been in there for a bit. So that was the race shop office lunchroom area. Yeah.
The race shop for the Rockstar Suzuki.
Oh, yeah. We loved having you in there.
But it's funny because that building, I'm sure you know, Brandon, but that building was, before you had it, they used to film pornos there.
They did. Yeah, the whole thing. So the whole thing was jet black.
Yeah.
And then had the rails around the thing, I guess, for the cameras to roll. I don't know. And then the offices were all bedrooms.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was pretty.
There was some DNA in those offices.
Yeah.
Right?
So. Yeah. Okay. So it's funny because the new building we're in right now, so that one was a porno building.
Uh-huh.
So the new one that we're in right now was a church.
Oh, my God. So you guys are repenting.
Yeah.
100%.
Yeah.
Okay, so the history of Bill's Pipes, it started, was it with Flat Track, right?
It was with Flat Track,
and
yeah.
I remember Bill has built pipes for guys like Wayne Rainey and
fact, I just spoke with Wayne other day and got to catch up with Wayne a little bit, you know, and because actually Wayne was Bill's first employee.
Really?
Yeah. Wayne Wayne was Bill's first employee. He would come after school and run over and help Bill and I know I don't think Bill took Wayne to the races, but I know Bill was really involved at that point with Wayne. Wayne was always really fast, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So Wayne was Bill's
first employee. It was Flat Track first, and then did it go into three-wheelers?
It was Flat Track first and then three-wheelers.
Three-wheelers, yeah. And then transition to quads
because Donnie
Banks.
Then that's when we met Donnie Banks, and then.
Okay, and then Moto.
And then
Moto. And the story with that was Yamaha invited exhaust manufacturers to build pipes for Damon Bradshaw.
Right. So, Bill got a phone call from, McCarthy or somebody, you know, said, you know, we're offering the three big manufacturers a shot at, you know, submit whatever you want to us, and Damon's going to test them, and whatever pipes he likes, that's what we're going to run for that season.
And it was a works pipe too, right?
What's that?
It was a factory pipe in there too, wasn't there?
To test against their stuff too, mm-hmm. which is their factory bike. So they just really wanted Damon to win, you know? So we built one, you know, Bill came up with the dimensions I built the pipe and actually totally forgot that we even submitted one pipe, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So it was probably about 3 weeks to a month later, Bill comes out and he goes, dude, you're not going to believe it, but Damon picked our pipe over the rest of them.
Yeah.
So we're like, wow, because we didn't do motocross. We were three and four wheel and dirt track.
Yeah.
So, Damon just catapulted us into the motocross.
Okay, I have a question. So, obviously, I've seen Bill. I've witnessed it, right?
Yeah.
His math equations and drawing out cones and stuff. But did they leave the works bike with you to create this pipe?
Or how no. did you, how, you know what? To be what honest, specs? Yeah, to be honest.
Off a stock bike?
Yeah, it was off a stock bike. It was off a stock bike. So you're absolutely right. I didn't really even think about that. I don't believe they gave Bill, there's no way they gave Bill the porting specs. You just wouldn't do that. So no, I remember the bike that we had in there, it was a stock bike.
That's crazy.
So yeah, the porting must have matched up well enough, you know? Uh-huh. So yeah, that is how we catapulted into motocross. And then
was Bill's pipe available as accessory in the GYTR catalog or something?
So it was. So at one point Yamaha came to Bill and asked us if we would, produce their GYTR stuff. Well, it was our pipe, and we just put their tag on it.
Yeah.
So we did do that for, a couple years, but man, the profit margin's pretty low on so I think we did it for a couple years, and then it just wasn't profitable just because we weren't able to produce enough, mm-hmm. So yeah, I'm not even sure who's building the GYTR stuff now. I know they're still doing it, though.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. So it went from Bradshaw and then Doug Henry and Team Honda.
So then. So Bill had always done the flat track, the factory Honda flat track two-stroke stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So they already knew. The flat track guy always knew of Bill. So I think the flat track guys at one point went to the motocross guys and goes, hey, why don't you try this guy's, he can make a good pipe. So the same thing, Bill, went down there and met Cliff White at the time, but mm-hmm. Cliff's another smart one, man. He really made those 125s go, because they're for that period, the 93 to 96 or whatever. Gosh, those Team Honda bikes, they were so fast.
Yeah. Lammy and Doug.
Doug and Lammy, man. It wasn't uncommon to go one and two. They were so fast.
Yeah, the talk was always they had 40 horsepower back in the day.
Well,
that was the goal.
Because you remember, horsepower. Donnie, yeah. Back in the day, you get 40 horsepower of a 125.
You're winning.
And they dirt, Cliff White. Cliff White was the one, man. I don't know how much Japan helped Cliff, but I do know Cliff was the one that put his hands on the motor. Mm-hmm. So in that case, so with the factory Yamaha deal, no, we never had a factory Yamaha motor. But then when we got hooked up with Honda, yeah, absolutely, we had a factory mm-hmm. factory Honda motor in that bike, and it just stayed on the dyno all the time.
Back then it was an engine dyno.
It was an engine dyno.
Oh, there's no motorcycles.
Yeah.
It was an engine dyno. Yeah. So Bill built
it, right?
No, a guy in the dirt tracker guys will know who Shell Thewitt is. He was a big dirt track motor builder.
Mm-hmm.
Bill bought that thing from him.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah. So so then we eventually got rid of that and then bought a dyno jet wheel dyno.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what it stayed on. So they put, yeah, yeah.
And then, so, tons of success with Suzuki followed, right?
So then, yeah. So then we did from 94 to 97 with factory Honda.
Mm-hmm.
And then, to be perfectly honest, I'm not sure why we transitioned. But then, yeah, then we got hooked up with Roger mm-hmm. At Factory Suzuki. So then we did the Factory Suzuki from 98 until, till the four strokes came along in 04.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Yep.
And that's that Factory Suzuki story is a great story. That needs to be, from when they had the Rockstar team, how the Rockstar team went away. That's like one of the most, not hidden stories, but like it's a great story of what happened to Bill's, how come Bill's was so prominent, mm-hmm. at the two strokes, and then four strokes come around, and all of a sudden they kind of disappeared when you had a team with Jason Lawrence, Mike Brown, Ryan Mills, a lot of top fast guys at the time. And it's something he's got to tell at one point.
Yeah. Well, the Suzuki history, though, was long and in many different stages, right? Because I know it was factory with Travis Pastrana and stuff. And then there was the Primal Impulse Suzuki team.
Yeah, right? The Primal, forgot about that.
That Bobby was King.
So that actually, Horton. So that actually, because that transitioned, was the same when we transitioned from Honda to the Suzuki. Mm-hmm. Well, we were already kind of in bed with Primal Impulse, you know. Yeah. So
what was that guy's name?
It was Kurt Clovis.
Kurt Clovis, dude. Yeah.
Yeah. And he was a really good dude too.
He was from Texas.
He was from Texas. Came from oil.
Mm-hmm.
Uh huh. So, and he just another guy that just loved the sport, you know. So we started off with factory with Honda with the Primal because we were with factory Honda. So of course we did that. So then once we went factory Suzuki, then our Primal thing went Suzuki as well.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And
then so factory Suzuki, and then so the Rockstar Suzuki team was Bill's Pipe's first endeavor into, I take it back, because I remember you guys were at the races with the Primal Honda team.
Yeah, so the Primal was for sure.
With Rainer.
Yeah, Robbie,
and Craig Decker.
Yeah, he was so fast. And we got to work with super fast guys. But Robbie, he, as far as natural talent, everybody knows Robbie. Yeah. Robbie was super good. Buddy Antunez was crazy good at arena cross. It was like his own niche, you know. He just, but he was good, man. He just was savvy, and he knew how to win.
Mm-hmm. Him and Denny would go 1 and 2 left, you know.
Oh yeah, one season. I think because back then the arena crosses, it's a little different than now. You actually rode a 125. And then a 250 all in the same night.
Yeah, yeah.
You didn't have to, but if you were going for points, you did.
And it was great money.
And they were making
as much as Supercross or more.
Yeah, so one season it was Buddy and Denny Stevenson, and I'm not kidding you. I think between those two guys, I think they won like 66% of the main events. just killed it. They just killed it. Bud Man, you know, I'm not sure what the Bud Man's doing right now. I know he's doing,
he's coaching.
He's doing a little bit of a lot of things. Yeah. With yeah. Ping. He's announcing, coaching, but Buddy's a good dude too. Yeah.
But the transition into the Rockstar Suzuki Bill's Pipes team.
Yeah.
It is so funny is I remember, cause I was still in the back. Working,
right. Oh yeah. Yeah. Transfer, yeah.
But I remember there was a RMZ 250.
So and like that 06, was the 05, 06.
That was the Strategic Alliance year when it was also the same as Cowie. A Cowie.
Yeah.
But I remember you guys had a bike out front with paper, like graphics printed on paper, taped to the bike. And I don't remember who was it from Rockstar. Was it Kelso that was there? That was like, he was looking at the bike and he goes, why does it have to say Suzuki? Why does it have to say Bill's Pipe? We aren't Rock. I think there was like 17 or 18 Rockstar logos on the bike.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep.
Was that Kelso then?
It was Kelso. Yeah. Right.
That was so funny. He's like, why does it have to say Suzuki?
Yeah. They, I think they were, that was their first endeavor with the motocross, you know, and the whole way that came about was, you know, we'd always dabbled in our own Primal stuff, you know, or smaller race teams. And well, the Primal wasn't that small. We had, you know, we had five or six, you know, box vans on the road. In fact, one time at that shop, our guys were debating. It was the National debating whether to leave that day or just get up in the morning early and get in the box vans and leave to go to Hangtown. Well, they decided to leave in the morning. They go pulling in like at 5 in the morning. All six of our box vans were on stilts in the back of the shop.
Oh, shit.
You don't remember that, Donnie?
Uh-uh.
All six of them.
Stole all the wheels?
Were on blocks, stilts, whatever the people could find. And yeah, they were all aluminum Alcoa wheels on them, you know. The windows were broken out. Luckily, they didn't get in the back because the things were loaded.
Yeah, yeah.
They didn't get in the back because the guys had the band, the
pulled up against the building,
all backed up against the building.
Yeah.
So they just jacked them up, put them on whatever they could, stole all the wheels, and then boom, went in and stole whatever they could out of it, which was, of course, the CBs, you know, the radios.
Mm-hmm.
One of the guys did have his briefcase with money in it, you know, but yeah, yeah. So the team, the Primal team wasn't small, you mm-hmm. know, it was fairly big, but yeah, then we jumped to the Rockstar, but that was somebody, I'm wanting to say, man, it was maybe somebody like Cole Gress might've went, man, you guys need to step up and do a program, you mm-hmm. know, or like. Well,
okay, that team was maybe Jason Lawrence, Mike mm-hmm. Brown, Ryan Mills,
Sean Hamlin.
Sean Hamlin. Yep, Sean. So there's four guys, right? Or was there more?
Yeah, well, so there was four, and then I know that that Cole had us do Josh Woods
yeah.
for a little bit.
Yeah, okay. Right.
It's like number 56 but yeah, or something. Yeah.
So how long did that team last?
So
was it one season or was it two?
No. I mean, this is something I really, really never discussed too okay. much.
It was what I was talking about.
It was. It's pretty much.
Tell.
Yeah, it's pretty much the demise of Bill's Pipes, to be honest.
Hey, because can I go to the bathroom real quick. Huh? Can you stop it right there? Can I go to the bathroom real quick?
Yeah. Well, let's take a break to hear from our sponsor. Factory Backing has been producing custom motocross graphics since 2004. At Factory Backing, they prioritize quality by using the finest vinyl materials available. Their competitive prices might seem surprising, but rest assured, they offer top-notch products specifically designed for motocross and the demands of dirt bike riders. Check them out at factorybacking.com. Welcome back to the Midweek Podcast, presented by Factory Backing. All right. Let's hear it. The story. Rockstar Suzuki.
This is the story.
This is it.
Yeah, so...
and this we is did. The most common question we always get. Well, what happened to Bill's Pipes?
What happened to Bill's Pipes, yeah. So, we... this was a transition. It was kind of bad timing for us to take on our very first factory team, basically.
When everything was going four-stroke.
When everything was going four-stroke.
Mm-hmm.
Because we for sure obviously knew our two-stroke game.
Yeah.
Four-stroke, nobody was really, really sure. Mitch at Pro Circuit was the smartest to go out and get that Drano guy. That Drano guy came from car racing. Guy mm-hmm. was smart, man. So that's part of the reason why Mitch just completely dominated for... How many years did he dominate?
It was a while,
like I mean, 4 or 5 years. His bikes were so fast.
Yeah.
Were so fast. So, anyways, we did the team, and it was a verbal 2-year program.
And that's the agreement Bill had with Rockstar and with Suzuki.
With the Rockstar mm-hmm. Suzuki. So we get going, and let's see. Let me get all my ducks in a row. It's been a bit since I've actually talked about it. So we go the first problem with these bikes were this was in 2004. Well, that's when Cowie was building the bike for Suzuki.
Yeah, Strategic Alliance.
Yep. So Cowie's bike was a little different than Suzuki's bike. They made some small changes. Mm-hmm. They updated trannies. They made some. So in other words, the Cowie was at that point a little bit better than mm-hmm. a Suzuki. So to be perfectly honest, the Suzuki wasn't a very good bike.
Mm-hmm.
Put it this way, like our full race bike that we came up with at the end of the day when 06 came in, Suzuki at that point did come out with their new one. The very next year was Suzuki's own bike. Mm-hmm. When I dynoed the 06, which is our pipe, and like a mild work done to it, was already faster than what our last year's full race bike was.
Okay.
So it, I felt bad for our riders like the whole year, Jason,
Ryan,
all of them, mm-hmm. all of them, Ryan, Sean, because
Brown was still on
Mike Brown. No. Brownie was,
Supercross he was.
Brownie was, he rode, the 250 in Supercross, but then outdoor Brownie was on it. And
yeah,
that motor couldn't hold up to Brown.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I remember one time it, I think it was Unadilla. Dude, I think Brownie might have qualified like third fastest. But in that qualifying time, we went through two motors.
Oh, my God.
We blew up one at the end of the first one
mm-hmm.
and blew up one at the end of the second one. And in that time, Brownie qualified third fast. He was flying. But it was a tough decision because he couldn't even make it through qualifying, you know? Mm-hmm. So we're like, Mike, dude, we'd be stupid to send you out in a full-blown 35-minute moto when we can't even make it through.
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
So we're like, dude, I'm sorry, man. It was a tough call. You know, we're going to have to sit this one out. I mean, our bike just won't hold up. So that was the only time we had to do that. But that was, as a team manager, that was tough to do. I mean, like, are you kidding me?
Was that the cam issue time too?
That's why, yeah.
Yeah, set of bad cams. Yeah. Given.
Yeah, and it was just really overheating the motor. So the whole year was just terrible, you know, because we were fighting a bike.
Mm-hmm.
You know, our bikes were better than any other Suzukis besides Roger and Ian's Makita Suzuki. They had
probably Izzy.
No.
Brian Gray?
No, it was Hepler. It was Brock.
Yeah.
And Brock was good, man. I'm wanting to say their bike probably was a little better than ours. I'm sure it was. But other than that, we had all the other Suzukis covered.
Mm-hmm.
So then Cole, it was, like I said, it was a 2-year deal. So it was like we had 3 or 4 races left of outdoor, and Cole came to us and said, he goes, hey, I just want to let you know that, dude, the second year ain't happening.
Mm-hmm.
So we're like, what? And they're like, Factory Suzuki gave this program to Yosh. So we're like,
well, and they have a lot of money. Bills has millions of dollars out.
Well, yeah. So here's the thing. We went into it knowing what we were going to do, and we knew budget wise how deep we were going to be into it the first year, but the second year everything was going to pay off, and we weren't in doing the team to actually make money. We were just doing the team to get the name out there in the four-stroke world. So that's basically what we were doing it for. Not necessarily to make money off of the team. It mm-hmm. was just to get our name out. So we did the math and we knew, yeah, you know, it looks like you're going to be, after all the dust settles, you're probably going to be somewhere in the neighborhood of $500,000 in the negative running mm-hmm. this team. So we're like, okay, because on the other end, everything was paid for. You know, we bought a semi, all the stuff. At the other end, the next year, yeah, we were going to be in the positive probably above 500,
mm-hmm.
you know? So we're like, okay, no brainer, you know, it's not a big, you know, yeah, we're going to hurt the first year, but the second year is going to be good.
But Bills is doing good then. There's a lot of two-stroke pipes flying out the door.
Bills was doing good then. So, okay, we did it. So then Cole came to us and said, hey, you're not going to have the team next year.
Mm-hmm.
There's been a problem at Suzuki, and Yoshimura is fired up, and they want this team.
Mm-hmm.
So we're like, all right, you know, what can we do? So at the end of the day, I was jumping around a little bit. At the end of the day, Scott Sepkovic was the manager for the riders, but he's also the one that brought in the rock star money. Mm-hmm. So when that team was dissolved the next year, Sepkovic wasn't going to be part of that program either. So Scott, in hindsight, Scott did the right thing. He sued Suzuki. I should word it differently. He sued Rockstar Suzuki because he wasn't going to get paid money for the next year as well, just like we weren't. So I remember I had to sit through it was a complete day deposition with Factory Suzuki lawyers, myself and a stenographer. And I just answered questions all day long. And at the end of the day, I was supposed to be to court the next day on, I don't even know whose behalf I was going to be on, but Scott was suing Suzuki, so I was going to have to be there. So I get a text or a phone call like 11 o'clock that night and go, there's no need to go to the court tomorrow. It's been resolved. Mm-hmm. So Rockstar Suzuki settled with Scott. I didn't even ask what he got, whatever, but they settled. Mm-hmm. So I always told Bill, I go, Bill, man, Scott didn't lose money. We lost money. Mm-hmm. Scott still got, he didn't get as much money. Well, he was going to for sure lose the next year money. But we actually lost money that year. Mm-hmm. So I told Bill, I go, Bill, man, we should have did that. We probably should have jumped on that lawsuit. And Bill's like, once you sue a big player in this game right here, you'll basically be back blackballed. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, really? And he goes, yeah, I mean, you just don't do it. You just don't sue a big manufacturer like this. So I'm like, all right. So that is what put Bill's Pipes into a huge hole.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Was that.
Real quick, explain to him the circumstance of
it's such a trippy story that it really had nothing to do with us, because all of our sponsors, like Jason did well, really well a couple times.
Jason Lawrence,
yeah, he did really well a couple times. And Jason was, he was fast. Everybody knows Jason Lawrence story. He's super fast. So all of our sponsors were super happy with the way that our team did. It was presented good. It looked good. The semi, the bikes looked good. Yeah. The riders looked good. So all of our sponsors were always happy as Bill's Pipes, because when you like an exhaust company or a motor builder company and you sponsor a team, and then you're going up against Pro Circuit, because at that time FMF wasn't even winning races yet. Mm-hmm. It was Pro Circuit. So when you got to go up against Mitch at Pro Circuit and Mitch has got, he's winning, and then your guy, you're doing eighth, ninth, tenth. It helped, but I mean, Pro Circuit's 1, 2, and 3, mm-hmm. So you really want to be up in the front. So we weren't really pumped on the way we did, getting 5th, 6th, and 7th. We weren't happy with that. Our riders weren't happy. They wanted to do better. But our sponsors were happy. Mm-hmm. They were happy to get a 5th, a 4th, a 6th. They were happy. So for going on to that next year, they're like, they were up in the salary. So one of my good buddies, Corey Kiesel, was one of the owners of Moto Metal. He was bringing in four-wheel parts for the next year.
KMC.
Moto Metal was up in there. So on the table, we had a lot of money set up to profit from that next year. Well, then at the end, that next year didn't come. So then my buddy called me. He goes, man, Jeff, Corey Keyes at Moto Metal. He goes, we're buds. I know we're buds, but man, our company did really well off of you guys. So it looks like it's the same team. It's just you guys are out. Dude, are you going to be bummed if we follow with that team? And I go, Corey, you got to go with the team. You know, mm-hmm. You can't not do it just because we're friends. So he did. He Moto Metaled, you know, shifted over with that. So with all that being said, we got to the bottom of exactly why Suzuki jumped ship from us to Yosh. And it really had nothing to do with Bill's pipes. It's a crazy story. So Ricky Carmichael is the reason this all happened. So you didn't know this, Donnie? Mm-hmm. Oh shoot. So Ricky Carmichael was factory Suzuki in the 250 class for Supercross. He was going to ride the two stroke, which was pro circuit.
Okay.
So 04 was a trippy, or 06 was a trippy year for Suzuki, because they had us, Bill's Pipes, doing the 125 program. They had pro circuit doing the 250 program, 250 two-stroke program. Yeah. And they had Yosh doing the four-stroke program, because Yosh, you know, big-time four-stroke.
Street bikes, road racing.
Yeah, Yosh was always big-time, yeah. Big-time four-stroke. They did really well. So Ricky was only going to do two strokes for Supercross only. And then from that point, he was jumping to four stroke, which at that point, he was leaving pro circuit, which he's been a lifer, and then jumping to Yosh because mm-hmm. it was the four stroke. That was the whole plan. Everybody knew it. So Ricky's doing his testing on the four stroke. Well, I guess he wasn't super, super pumped on, and you got to know that Ricky just came off of factory Honda and just killed it. Mm-hmm. Just, was that a perfect season year?
Yeah, I think so.
I think he ended that.
So Ricky's coming off a perfect season year with factory Honda. So Suzuki's got a lot of weight on their shoulders, you know. They got Ricky Carmichael, you know, and he was at that point, he's the man. So Ricky really wasn't super, super pumped on the bike at that point. So I guess Mitch at one point towards the very end, Mitch sent Ricky a four stroke system. And Ricky put it on his bike and said, "No, this is what I want." Mm-hmm. So then
Yosh had a bunch of money out in advertising, and you so know, got Ricky Carmichael come in, and it was going to be a big deal. I mean, it was
a big deal.
So Ricky going to pro circuit, the other team was switched to Yosh as a
make yeah. Good? So at the I'm talking like 2 weeks before the first national. Is Ricky tells Roger, he goes, I like this pro circuit pipe. That's what I'm running.
Ah.
That's what I'm running.
Okay.
So I don't even know what must have happened behind closed doors on that deal, because, I mean, well, you, like Brandon
ties,
said.
Supposedly they were going to cut ties with American Suzuki.
Well,
they were,
well, I mean, so not only that. So Ricky goes up up to Hangtown. That was the first race. And he does. He goes 1-1. And he even thanked Pro Circuit on the podium. Mm-hmm. So here comes Monday morning. So Yoshimura in Japan, they're like brothers, because they at that point they'd been doing Suzuki's program for 30 something years. They were literally like brothers back there. So they were so livid about what had all happened, and then just the dagger at the end with Ricky thanking Pro Circuit. They were like, man, we're done. Mm-hmm. We're done with you guys. So then that's how they said, well,
what can we do?
What can we do? What can we do? Mm-hmm. So then that's when they go, well, we want that 250 program. That was our program.
So why wasn't there a contract sign? Why was
that's
that?
The craziest thing.
Is that Bill's MO?
That's Bill's MO.
That's Bill's MO.
He's just a nice, trusting. He takes everybody.
So I don't know whether Scott had his stuff done in ink, but I know that Bill that I don't believe that full 2-year deal. It was I'm wanting to say it was verbal only. And I don't know if it was verbal only with Scott, but whatever Scott, he sued and he did win.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Know? So this whole Suzuki thing,
yeah,
you know, you kind of, I think it was a little dramatic saying it was the demise of Bill's Pipes. Cause obviously you guys are still here.
Well,
but,
no,
but it was a big blow.
It was a huge blow. So, it put Bill's Pipe in a huge financial burden, right? Mm-hmm. So then at that point forward, it was just a constant battle.
But mm-hmm. Bill kind of wanted to withdraw. I mean, that was tragic, right? I mean, that was, you know, you build up, you got this race team, you got this big presence, you're a major player, and then it's gone. So, you know, you have semis, you have mechanics, you got engine, you have all these things going on that you have to now sell off to try to recoup some of the money you lost.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, Bill, you know, kind of took more emphasis on racing than the business side of things, you know, because, you know, we get sucked into it. We love to go to the races.
Oh, yeah, that's, it's a great sport.
You know, who wants to be worried about what pipes we got going out the door, what we're selling when, hey, we got on the podium, or, hey, you know, this rider wants to come, you know, to the team next year. You know, there's just always something, and racing is very addicting. Winning is very addicting. So it's after that happened, he was over it. I mean, he was over the racing scene. He was over motocross stuff because just left a really sour taste here. He had trusted someone that, how could you lie to me? You know, and Jeff is the same way. They're very genuine, very trusting people. And, you know, it's bit Bill's Pipes more than once, just us trusting the wrong people to do the right thing. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's tough, but it's lessons that the company had to learn and going forward. You know, it's not going to happen again.
Yeah. Brandon, when did you come into the company?
Right around 2014. It was right around 2014 or so. I came in originally to work for, I was at Bazaz. Bazaz was a fuel management system, and it was street bikes, and we did some dirt bike stuff, and I learned a lot. Amar was a great, a very smart guy, but I just wasn't really into the street bike scene.
Mm-hmm.
I came over to Bill's, and I was actually working for Big Gun Exhaust, which I originally was one of Mike Young's first employees in 97 at Big Gun when he started it.
Okay.
So I knew the brand. I came over, and I knew they were kind of partners with Bill's. I knew Bill's from the outside looking in with growing up with Greg Schnell and racing against Ping, racing against Brandis, racing against, you know, Raynard and all those, Decker and those guys at that same time. I knew they had fast bikes and good stuff. So Schnelli was a big time PC guy, but, you know, we knew Bill's Pipes was a major threat, like a major player, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So coming over to Bill's Pipes, you know, working for Big Gun, just wasn't into it. I wasn't into the quad stuff. I wasn't into, you know, it just wasn't really me. And I would see Jeff testing and trying to make the pipes better and you know, dynoing all the time and really putting a lot of effort into making the exhaust the best it could. And I'm like, hey, I want to be part of that. You know, we're in the same building. I'm looking and I'm always bugging him, you know, watching him on dyno and, hey, I'll set it up. I'll change that tire, whatever.
Yeah.
And I just was like, hey, I want to work for Bill's Pipes. So the Big Gun thing was very short lived, even though we were in the same building. You know, I, at the end of the day, I wanted to be involved with motocross. That's what I've been around basically my entire life. And so, you know, that's kind of where it took off from there.
Okay. So right now we're halfway through 2024.
Right.
Okay. So halfway through 2024, let's bring us up to date now.
Yeah.
Bill's Pipes, I think you have a new partner.
Yeah.
Yep.
John DeRosa.
Yep.
And you guys are making a big push again. So.
Right. Right. So back it up just a teeny bit. So then once Bill had been diagnosed with dementia, he had made unfortunately a couple pretty bad business decisions, you know. So we actually had to sell the building. Bill basically, I don't know if the dementia really kicked in or just depression or what, but it hit him really hard.
So he was just done.
He was just literally done. And my mom had OCPD to where she was on oxygen 24/7. Mm-hmm. So Bill's like, hey, I'm just going home. I'm just take care of your mom, you know. So I'm like, all right, Bill, no problem. So we sold the building. And he goes, well, you can do what you want with it. So me and Brandon, we picked up the pieces and then moved over to Harupa, mm-hmm. you know, where we are now. And
we didn't really have a place to go. We were kind of trying to figure it out.
We didn't have
at the end of the day, we didn't really know, you know, what we were gonna do.
And
we ended up talking to Dan Lamy. Over at DASA Racing, and he had a guy there that basically was same as me. His name's Kevin Johnson, and he just was like, hey, we got a couple bays, you know, it's small, but you know, you guys can rent this from us, and you know, just jump right in. And it was very smooth, easy, and it was a lot of work. I mean, Bill's had been at that Corona facility for a long time, and there was a lot of stuff that had to be gone through, right? So, you know, we moved all of our stuff over. Our guys came with us, and you know, we were struggling. I mean, we were just paying. There was a lot of debt that we had to overcome, mm-hmm. and get taken care of that, you know, frankly, we didn't know about. So mm-hmm. coming out of the shop in Corona. And you know, a lot of our people that we use, our vendors, were like, "Hey, you got a bill for $15,000. You got a bill for this. You got a bill for that." And I'm going, "What?"
Yeah.
You know, so I was always confused on the whole thing because, you know, I was always told that if we did a lot of work for a lot of people, a lot of other exhaust companies, you know, we did Harley stuff, we did side by side doors and you know, roll cages. And there's just a lot of influx of money coming in and out. At the end of the day, I'm going, well, where is it? Mm-hmm. Well, if you're making money, how come we're not making money?
So sorry, Brandon, just to back up to where Brandon's at right now. So in now hindsight, we all kind of knew that Bill had dementia back then, but we didn't know it mm-hmm. at that time.
Right, right.
Because Bill had another guy running the office. So like I was always developing and
he was like head down and focused on.
I never even went in the office. Like I had a Bill's Pipe credit card. I never even activated the strip, you know? Mm-hmm. I never even went on any of that side of it. I never bought anything. Bill did everything. So at the one point, Bill let this this kid Jason that came from Big Gun, he let him run the office. Mm-hmm. Which I didn't have any controls of the computer just because I didn't want to. Brandon didn't have any controls of the computer.
I was just looking at sales stuff.
Brandon was a sales, so that's all the part he could see. And so Bill at this time really wasn't doing any running of the business. He was just out, you know, buying material, you know, just overlooking that type of stuff. So there was a kid in the office that was actually running the business.
Mm-hmm. And it was just a lot of mismanagement.
Just mismanagement, man.
So, you know, we were always, Jeff and I were asking, hey, how's everything, you know? Oh yeah, we're great. Oh, we're doing good, you know? And at one point Bill was telling us, you know, hey, we're, you know, the building's almost paid off, this, that, the other. We're thinking we're going in the right direction, and I'm focused on sales. I have Tucker Rocky now that I brought in. I have, you know, three or four small racing satellite teams. I got HEP, you know, running the exhaust. So we were getting out there and we're growing. We really ran into a problem when we came to the other shop with stamps and the two-stroke stuff. So, you know, our two-stroke stuff's our bread and butter, and it came to a time where, you know, we were running out of stamps. So we're looking at other alternatives to getting stamps and not waiting 18 weeks or whatever if you place an order. Mm-hmm. And we didn't have a ton of money, so we couldn't place these huge orders that some of the companies were asking. We need a small run of stamps, not like a huge run, because we didn't have the sales. Mm-hmm. So it was a big, you know, a lot of ups, a lot of downs. Thankfully Jeff is you know, we've have a good reputation, and you know, sometimes, you know, our personalities are yin and yang, but we make a good team. Bringing John DeRosset in, Jeff brought John DeRosset in to come in and really take it to the next level. Get, you know, he's an avid, not a racer, he's not a motocross guy, but he's like a desert guy. So he's into bikes, very, you know, very smart businessman with a great background with his family and whatever. So, you know, he came in and he brought structure to us. Mm-hmm. So, you know, instead of me fumbling, trying to figure out our taxes or, you know, any of that stuff. And he came in and really, really brought his whole team with him. And we've added Jeff's daughter, Courtney, to our team, who's really just out of college and taken a huge role in running our operations as far as accounting wise and learning all that stuff. So,
well, she's got good people, like he's saying, John's team. Mm-hmm.
He's got a good foundation behind him.
He's got some smart ladies behind him.
You can't really screw up, because they'll say, that's, yeah, it's not supposed to be like that.
So if Courtney runs into a problem, she just calls Don. That's his main one, and she, Don handles it. So she's doing so well. You know, I'm really proud of her. But she's also got somebody really good to lean on. Yeah.
So having that IT department behind us now, having came in, we got our website back. You know, we didn't have our website a long time. People were like, is this fraud? You know, yeah. Because we're ordering.
Yeah, we didn't even have a phone number.
Yeah, we're selling through Instagram. It was, you know, at the old shop, we had our website, and for some reason, it just all of a sudden just disappears. And hey, can we get it back? I'm asking questions to the people that are running the office. Hey, can we get it back? What's going on? Nope, it's gone. We can't get it back. We lost it. And we're not the smartest, you know, tech savvy people. So we're just kind of like, oh, okay, now what, you know? And at the time we really didn't have, you know, the product to, so, you know, have a website that, you know, people are ordering, then what?
Yeah.
So fast forward, we brought in-house stamping, for our two strokes. Jeff there's two things that he took over that he's just a smart guy. That's really impressed me is he learned how to do bending, which is very, very, very hard to do. He learned how to do bending out of necessity for us. Mm-hmm. And then he also learned how to stamp pipes for us. So we got this 15,000 pound press that, you know, it's 150, I mean, it's 20 feet high.
Yeah.
And Jeff learned how to set up the tooling, how to get this stuff doing. So we're bringing all that stuff in and stamping our stuff in house now. And it's a learning process, but it's been a fast process. So, mm-hmm. You know, we're bringing back old models, you know, stuff that we didn't have. We're working on the 500 now as we speak, mm-hmm. to bring back stuff. Because a lot of the other manufacturers, they basically only do so many, and then you're on a waiting list. So we can stamp out as we need to.
Yeah.
So it's going to be a lot better for us to be able to keep stuff in stock, cater to some of these groups that think we don't care about them. You know, what about the O2, you know, KX125? You guys just don't give a shit. You know, it's like, we do, just need the tooling. And so now we've worked through the process of manufacturing our own stamps, which is half of our business.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the two-stroke is half of the business, and then, or maybe even more than that. But now, making our four-strokes better is our priority. So we've really revamped our RE13. They developed a, Jeff came up with, and one of the other guys came up with a new inlet system that not only helps with sound, it creates power. So
I have to say the KX450 system, it's quieter than stock and it works really amazingly well.
Right.
Yeah. As does the 350 SXF.
Yeah.
That system's really good.
So we compare all of our stuff against the competitors. Mm-hmm. So we know where we're at. It's not like we're throwing spaghetti at the wall. And you know, we're really stoked on the sound, changing the cores, changing the packing, going with a more durable, style of packing. I mean, the packing that we're using now is like four times the amount cost wise of what we were doing before, but the durability, the sound, and just the maintenance that you do not have to do before is huge.
Mm-hmm.
So we're learning those steps. And then, you know, we're speaking, we're working on titanium. You know, we know we have to have a titanium version of our RE13, which we did before at one point.
We did before.
But we want to bring it back for all models, not just a selected few.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, you know, where we're going right now as we speak. So
awesome. All right. Yeah. So you have a new website.
Yeah.
What's the new URL? It's not just Bill's Pipes, it's something else.
It's billspipesusa.com.
Okay.
So www.billspipesusa.com. You know, our stuff is made in America. We don't have 100%. We're not buying products like some of these companies that are, you know, get a full exhaust in a box from China. Mm-hmm. You know, hey, that's what you want to do. That's not what we're about. We respect a lot of our, you know, competitors like, you know, Pro Circuit and FMF, you know, because they're another major company, I mean, American company that do build their stuff, you know, and it's, we've never had any issues with our quality. You know, it's more our supply and demand. And, you know, again, John coming in doing production orders and stocking up on things, and we're playing offense versus defense. And having that infrastructure, I mean, it's a different company.
Yeah.
It's a completely different company than it was even 2 years ago. So,
oh yeah,
we're just,
it's going, it's for sure. It's going at an incline. But our buddy, John, you know, our businessman, he's aggressive dude. He's younger.
Mm-hmm.
You met him.
Yeah.
He's younger and he's a big dude, isn't he?
So, yeah.
So anyways, he jumped in with both feet running, and he's actually a little bit in front of us,
mm-hmm.
as far as what we can keep up with him, you know? So, but we're getting there, you know, we are getting there, and every week, you know, Courtney and Brandon are seeing it, you know, that the Bill's Pipes is going, and Brandon does such a good job of, you know, getting the pipe out there to people, mm-hmm. and
well,
and if, and when we quit, well, when basically when Bill's Pipe kind of shut down for that minute, if Brandon wouldn't have wanted to do it, there's absolutely no way I would have done it. Either you come with me, or we're shutting it down, because, you know, I knew how to build pipes, and that was it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I knew how to do a little bit of other stuff, but he knew how to do a little bit of a lot of shit.
Yeah.
So I told him, I go, dude, if you're going to come with me, then we're going to do it. If not, then, you know, we'll just pack everything up in Bill's backyard and, you know, we'll go do something else, you know?
Yeah. Well, so, I'm glad you guys stuck it
out. No. And it is good. It's like I said, it's going for sure in a pretty, pretty steep ramp upward. We just gotta jump into the building the mass quantities now, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And the two strokes, we're doing pretty good on that.
Oh, yeah.
We've upped our game pretty good on that. I think a lot of it is maybe because we do have the press.
And we have the manpower now. I mean, we're as big working for Bill's Pipes as we were, you know, 10 years ago at the old shop in Corona. We mm-hmm. have that many people working on Bill's Pipes now. So
yeah,
it's just started, you know, reaching out. We have an Australian distributor that I picked up, which was Lusty Industries. So they're helping us out huge in Australia. We just picked back up with Motorsport. You know, we had Tucker Rocky before they went BK or whatever happened to them, in the US, which had a great dealer network. And that was unfortunate what happened, but, you know, we really, really want to stay with these big companies like Motorsport or Dealer Direct, mm-hmm. and just not try to grow too big, but try to grow organically in the right direction where we can manage it and grow with it, versus just, you know, here's a, you know, $2 million PO, fill it.
Yeah.
And then you're going, you know, so it's fun. We're in talks with some very quality race teams for 2025. We're very excited about partnering with. So you will be seeing Bill's pipes in the top five here in the near future. So that is, you know, something that's hasn't happened in a long time, and we're pretty stoked on it. You know, we're really stoked on the direction, because at the end of the day, we love racing, mm-hmm. you know, and it sucks, because it's like there's so many different variations of racing, and it's like we're so fixed on moto, like, or supercross or moto, like arena cross, yeah. like, you know, and we want to venture out and start doing more of the getting pipes out, specifically since we do our own stamping in the GNCC, you know, thicker gauge, stuff like that, mm-hmm. and making a Woods pipe specific for the KTM 300 or YZ250 or whatever the popular models are right now. So that's stuff that's on the table that we're also taking a look at. Quads, you know, we bought a Yamaha 450 YFZ that we're developing right now that's super close. We're going to jump into, you know, having some stuff done with that quad racing series as well. So
cool. Well, we are unfortunately out of time.
Yeah.
I've got a show I have to do here pretty soon, but let's get back together in a few months and let's get an update.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
There's other stories I want to delve into about the past. So, thanks for coming by.
And I gotta thank you too, Donnie, because I know that you and Bill from way back have been close friends, and you've always helped Bill.
Mm-hmm. You know, as long as it's bikes. I mean, it's all the 90% of the bikes we get to developer, you know, from Donnie. So, it's much appreciated, man.
Appreciate all you've done throughout the years. Yeah.
It's been a good several decades
of being
buddies.
And it's kind of cool to watch you grow too.
Yeah.
You know, because I get to
grow old, man.
Yeah. Well, I mean, when the Trans World thing went down, I mean, that's kind of, we were in the same boat. I mean, we get it.
Kind of the same boat.
We get it. You're kind of going, now what?
Yeah. I think the best quote from that whole time, and it relates to you guys too, is like, I was like, oh man, I don't know what I'm going to do. And Jeremy McGrath said, do your own thing. Business isn't hard. It's just scary because you haven't done it.
Right.
Right.
So, anyway, guys, thanks for checking out the Midweek Podcast presented by Factory Backing. See you next time. Factory Backing has been producing custom motocross graphics since 2004. At Factory Backing, they prioritize quality by using the finest vinyl materials available. Their competitive prices might seem surprising, but rest assured, they offer top-notch products specifically designed for motocross and the demands of dirt bike riders. Check them out at factorybacking.com.